right, we're back. This is the Big Curve Podcast, episode number 4. Episode 4.5 will be on Mixcloud later with all the music from today's show. I am Jeff. With me, as always, is Trampas.
What's happening, dude? Not much, man. How you doing?
All right. I'm going to try to keep your mic up this time. Right. Now you're going to have to watch what you say because people are going to be able to hear you.
So I'm just going to shut up.
So we have a really interesting topic today because, we're living in a crazy world. And as far as cancel culture and censorship and all this kind of stuff, and it really affects music.
Really? You think so?
I think it affects music, but
okay,
not the way that it's affected stand-up comedy, which apparently you can't talk about anything taboo anymore, or you're going to have half the staff at Netflix protesting, like the Dave Chappelle stuff.
Right.
And,
is there a part of you that think that he's just kind of an asshole?
Oh, I definitely think so.
Yeah.
I think so. However, I think that the way George Carlin got away with all of it and his content is because it wasn't a personal thing for him. He was presenting things as a character, kind of. You know what I mean? Well, this is crazy, and this pisses me off, and, But Dave's I was in a bar with a tranny. It's very specific to him.
Well, that last Carlin special, he's, talking shit about the homeless.
But you know what I'm saying? It's
it's pretty rough, man.
I just went back to his catalog because I watched the documentary. And during my drives, when I was driving the kids back and forth to camp, I'd put on a Carlin special on YouTube on my phone and just let it play through the stereo. And I mean, so much of it is so good.
Right.
But I want to turn Rollins, my kid, onto it. But I get through a little bit. I'm like, I'm not going to play this for him.
Right.
There's some stuff that's great that he would love. But I mean, it is really hate filled.
Right. I think when I was Rollins' age,
yeah,
I think I actually had a couple Richard Pryor albums.
Yeah, yeah.
I probably shouldn't have been listening.
No,
to
them, especially the one. What was it called? Superman.
Right. That man is crazy.
Ooh, yes. So comedy is starting to get affected, and I think that it's not that it's affecting it in a way where more stuff is going to be censored. I think it's going to stop comedians from certain from going certain places. I think that you still have, Bill Burr still going to say what he's going to say.
Right.
And, you still
he's not an asshole.
Yeah, I guess so. But I mean, I think that when he presents things, it's more like a, you know what I'm saying? You feel that way too. But Dave's comedy is it's great.
Second to none.
Yeah.
I mean, when he wants to be funny, it's funny. His last couple specials, I didn't think were that funny because he wasn't trying to be funny.
Right.
He was trying to preach to me.
Yeah. It's the delivery. And the way that he circles back to things way later in the show with the Bill Cosby stuff, it's great.
Yeah.
But, he gets into doing a 10-minute speech about I can't breathe and 6 minutes and what could I do in 6 minutes. It's that's more preachy spoken word.
Right, right.
Than it is, comedy.
Yeah.
But he
is hilarious. He's one of the funniest dudes ever, man.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'd say he's the top performer right now in comedy. Did you see him two nights ago at the Taylor Hawkins thing?
No, I saw him at the first one, but no, I didn't see him at the LA one.
Yeah, he comes out and sings Creep by Radiohead with Foo Fighters. And he's serious.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It's weird. I mean, it's not bad, but it's also not good. It's just kind of it's one of those things where 2 minutes into it, you're okay, I could do without. The shock of Dave Chappelle coming out and singing a Radiohead song is over after a minute. And it's just okay.
Right.
But anyways, I think that, it's a big topic every Christmas season with music because they always say, oh, baby, it's cold outside.
Oh, yeah.
And that brings it up usually around November, December every year. It fucking cycles through the news. It cycles through all of the, the music websites and social media, what's appropriate, what's not. And when it happened last year, I really started to dig in and say, well, what songs are really inappropriate? Meaning inappropriate, at any time. It's not that it's because of today's culture. This was never a good subject to talk about. You know,
are you talking about like David Allen Coe type shit, or
I'm not talking about blatantly racist stuff. I'm talking about you know, that Stone song "Brown Sugar." Everybody knows it, but there's a part in there about whipping slaves.
Right.
You know, it's kind of like, oh, well, that's not something I want to sing at a and snap my fingers to at a wedding.
Right.
They play that at weddings. It's like,
you know what's weird is back in the PMRC days.
Yeah.
Like, you know how they had the Filthy 15?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
None of those were about racism or hate.
Or rapey.
Yeah.
It was all like slightly maybe satanic or.
Right. Yeah. Like they had Venom. Darling Nikki.
I mean, there was right.
High and Dry by Def Leppard.
I mean,
because they were partying.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. Yeah. I looked through the internet to find a list that most fit the list that I came up with. Because a lot of these sites that do it, they'll actually cite certain lyrics and reasons why or why it would or would not be appropriate. Let's see here. It's weird, but, you know, I was having trouble with your mic last time, and now I hear you perfectly, and you're way down in the mix.
Really? Yeah, because like, I feel like I'm blowing out my headphones.
Right, and look, there you are right there.
Yeah.
I'm going to have to maybe just pull myself down. Here we go. All right. So we're going to get to that list in a few minutes, but first, we're going to do a little catching up since our last show, and then we have a very special guest joining us on today's show, the one and only Landis Expandis.
Sweet.
From Landis, Harry, Larry, Almighty Senators, F-City, and most notably, Dugan. So, we're going to pull him in just a little bit, but I wanted to give a couple of little life updates here. Since our last episode, I went to... What is going on? Did you hear that?
Yeah, it sounded like a... It sounds like drums or something like.
It sounds like a snare. Somebody's setting up drums. Yeah. What is going on? What? well, we'll figure that out later. But since our last show, I've been to two Hollywoods, and neither of them were College Park or Hollywood, Maryland, I think, which is down in Southern Maryland. I was in Hollywood, California, 2 weeks ago, and then this up until like 2 days ago, I was in beautiful Hollywood, Florida.
Nice.
Which is great when you're on the resort.
Uh-huh.
But Florida man is everywhere in Florida. I mean, it goes from 1 second, nothing but families and stuff like that, to like, you know, the guy walking down the street with just jorts.
Right.
No shirt, completely sunburned.
Right.
You know, smoking a cigarette that's literally burning the filter because and it's just hanging on his bottom lip, and he's drinking a tall boy natural light. Like, that's not one guy. That's like 80% of the population once you walk off the resort.
Right.
Which, maybe on the music show I'll play it, but Dingleberry Dynasty has a great song called Don't Leave the Resort, which I'll play that on the music show. But it's definitely the case. I mean, you know, Hollywood, Florida, I mean, the beach is beautiful. The weather's great. The water's great. You know, about 9 miles from the beach is the huge Hard Rock there that has a stadium. You know, where, you know, that's where, like, you know, Elton John and Billy Joel and, the big, like, a huge stadium there, great casino. Like, it's a decent place, but I don't think I'd live there.
Right.
Much like the other Hollywood in California, which I was at. I love going out there just because a lot of the things that people hate about Los Angeles is, like, the stuff I love. You know, it's like I love driving down the street and every billboard and every building is an advertisement for a show or a band. Like, I just like the feeling of it more than I like, you know, I like that feeling of being so close to entertainment where it's happening. It's a good feeling. I like it. We did meet a couple celebrities.
Yeah.
The first celebrity is the oddest celebrity. Celebrity is a very loose word for this person, but it's somebody that, what do you call a celebrity that everybody in the world has seen and knows of, but no one would know their name? Like, that's the kind of celebrity I'm talking about.
Right. Yeah. Okay. Like a character actor type?
No. The one of the teachers from the Hot for Teacher video. Like, we hung out with her.
Yeah.
You know, as soon as you say that, everybody's like, oh, okay. And I'm like, oh, the one in the black dress with the whip, you know, and the, oh, yeah, we know that, yeah.
Well, yeah. How old was she?
She's in her early 60s.
Yeah.
And she's holding up well.
Nice.
You know? So that was cool. She's one of the celebrities that it takes about 2 seconds for her to tell you who she is.
Right.
You know? Right. She came up to our road manager, my brother-in-law, Kevin, and he was wearing a Van Halen shirt. And we were up in the VIP, and she came right up to him and was like, oh, you like Van Halen? I was in the van, you know, and then it was right, right into there. And she's like, oh, look, here's me hanging out with Sebastian Bach, and here's the bit. And I was like, okay.
She said it was like looking for attention.
Yes. Yeah. And then the other guy we hung out with was Chips Enough.
Really?
Which I literally sat down and just talked to him about Howard Stern. Really? and Piano Madonna and all those stories that he used to tell. Yeah. Like, that's all we talked about. I didn't bring up any of his music. I was just talking to him about that. It was fun.
Yeah.
He was a really cool guy, man. Yeah. He was fun to hang out with. And it got us a gig because we're going to play at the Whiskey with Enough's Enough in April.
Oh, nice.
So we're going to be going out with them. You know, it's weird. I think Rollins mentioned it on the last show. They do like a 20 minutes of Beatles songs when they open their set, and then they play their hits.
Yeah, they were always more of a psychedelic hair band almost.
Yeah, yeah. So instead of playing like all their back catalog that nobody knows and then their two or three hits, they do all Beatles songs and then they play their two or three hits. It kind of works.
Yeah.
I don't know. It kind of works. So that was the Hollywood both Hollywoods. When we were heading back to the airport, we had to kill some time, so we stopped at an In-N-Out Burger and we're eating outside, and we were like kind of by Marina Del Rey, like not right on the water but back in the city. I mean, it was a parking lot of a Costco, so it wasn't, you know. And there was this apartment building right there, and I was just like, out of nowhere, I was like, I wonder how much it is to rent an apartment there. It's not in downtown LA, it's not in Hollywood, it's not in Burbank. Two bedroom apartment.
I'll guess 25 a month.
7 to 10,000 a month.
Jeez, wow.
and I was so shocked by that I'm like looking at the rooms and like it's like a bed. That's all that fit in there. Like I was like, who are all these people that are filling these houses in Los Angeles? Like
that is crazy.
They can't all be producers and writers and actors. Right. Like who are these people? Like, I can't figure out
who's going to pay that for an apartment.
I know.
Yeah.
Wow. I mean, that's so.
If it was like, you know, Manhattan.
Yeah, but even that, you'd be like.
Across the street from like Central Park or something.
Right. Those are the ones that you see like listed for $10 million. And you're going, for an apartment, you know? It's crazy. It's so crazy expensive. But we did get to do one cool thing that I'd never done before. And we got to drive through the Hollywood Hills.
Yeah.
Because we were going somewhere that is all highway and it was backed up. So Waze took us through there. And. Dude, that was really cool. Like Mulholland Drive, and like you go up to one part of the hill and you look, and there's like a line of houses all with infinity pools overlooking downtown. I mean, it was really cool to see.
Yeah.
You know, none of the people in the neighborhoods were happy that people are driving through there.
Sure.
Because it's a lot of the, you know, celebrity home tour buses and shit.
Right.
But dude, it's beautiful. It's ridiculous. It was a cool drive. It was a lot of cool scenery. Not like driving around Hollywood, Florida. Because again, once you leave the resort, but there is this little restaurant, not restaurant, like a little carryout place right next to the resort there. At it's all churros. That's all they do. But they make like churro bowls for ice cream and churro ice cream cones.
Oh, wow.
Dude, it's so good.
Yeah.
It's so good. It's really good.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good. So we... You didn't go on any trips or anything since the last, right?
Absolutely not.
Just hard at work, right?
Yep.
We never even really talked about what you know, Trampas always downplays what he does for a living. But the guy, he makes guitars, you know. He works for PRS, you know. Like, the guitars that you make are like the apartments that I saw in L.A.
Right.
They're like the best, most expensive guitars you can possibly get, right?
Right. Yeah.
I mean, there's not another brand that outprices or outclasses the technology, right?
I mean, there's a lot of high-end guitar makers now. Like, there's Collings and Austin, Texas. Like, they're really good.
Yeah.
I guess little boutique makers. But they're
like, boutique, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, there was one in Australia that made guitars for the guy who used to play in our band. They were called, like, Black Crow or Crow's Nest or some kind of Crow something. Crow? I don't know.
But it's actually amazing how the business has grown ever since they got John Mayer as an endorser.
Oh, for...
For PRS.
Oh, yeah. I'm sure.
Yeah.
But it's really cool. So you get to, like, you know, do you, like, do the colors? Like, what exactly? Because it's a big process, all the parts and all the...
Right, know. Yeah. It's like an assembly line
yeah.
kind of thing. And my job is to stain guitars as they come down the line.
Right. That's awesome.
Yeah. It is. It's a cool job. Like, if you had told me in kindergarten what I would do for a living, I'd be like,
never. Yeah, right. Yeah. Absolutely, man. That's really cool. So you've just been back hard at work. So we're going to go ahead here. We're kind of testing out how we're going to do some of these interviews. And, well, not really interviews, but more of these, like, guest appearances on the show. All right. We got Landis Expandis with us on today's show. What's up, Landis?
What's
up? How you doing, dude?
Good. How you doing?
We're doing all right. We're doing pretty good, you know? We wanted to get into today's subject, and we also want to talk to you about the three solo records that you just put out. So if you want to sit in there and hang with us for a little bit, we're going to do part of our list here, and then we'll go ahead and update on all the cool stuff going on in the Landis world. And
cool.
He's got a green screen, and he's wearing green. So it's like, I mean, I know no one could see this, but that's kind of what's going on there. So I just kind of see his head kind of floating.
It's one of my favorite colors.
One of them, yeah. Dude, speaking of green colors, man, that Lucky Charms leather jacket that you made is like the coolest jacket I've ever seen. And those jackets that you make, if you were selling them on Melrose, you'd be making like they have jackets just like that. Not just like that as in your particular artwork, but, you know, painted on jackets. And they go for, uh-huh, like, you know, $700 to $2,000.
Yeah, I know. I had started a business right before the pandemic, and I successfully sold two, and then the pandemic hit. But I had a fashion show with this other person who made coats and jackets, and I was off and running, and the pandemic just squashed it all. And I had to, like, reinvent myself again. I was like, okay, what can I do that's different? But I do kind of, you know, I miss it.
Yeah, I mean, this stuff, Trav, have you seen some of the stuff that the painted on clothes is just like, I'll show you a picture, and up on the YouTube version of this show, I'll put up hold on a second here. I'm gonna show you one of the jackets, one of my favorite ones did.
This
one right here.
It's too washed out because of the zoom. Hold on.
It's washing out. But you see, it's got like Lucky the Leprechaun, and it says Funkadelic under it.
Right.
And it's got all the studs and the spider webs. I mean, it's awesome. I mean, dude, that is just some cool stuff. I mean, we were seeing stuff just like that in Los Angeles, and dude, there was this one store, a whole side of the wall was nothing but old Chuck Taylors, like low top, old, like used, like there was dirt on them. And people like customized them with like paint and like little studs, and they were going for $800.
Yeah, it's like New York and LA are like different worlds. Like, it's like you're visiting a different planet. You go there and you'll see like a used t-shirt with a logo on it, and it's like, oh, $50. And you come here and it's like $2. An artist will sell a painting here. Can you do $75? Go New York, $1,000. It's like, is money the same thing there?
I don't think so. Well, I will say a lot of it is for show. Like, when I was shopping in Malibu, that's where things were really expensive, but I didn't see one person with a shopping bag. You know what I mean? Like, people were shopping, but I don't think they were buying anything. I think it was more of a, you know, and from what I understand on Melrose, like, a lot of that particular stuff is bought by props and costume people from movie and television. And they go down there and buy the stuff. It's not just common folk like me. But, dude, the vintage T-shirt thing is ridiculous. I was in a John Varvatos store, and they had an Iron Maiden T-shirt, and it was like $340, and it was used.
Yeah.
The craziest one I saw for expensive was this one shop. It was just called American Vintage or something like that. It was an Eddie Rabbit tour shirt.
Really? Wow.
Which I would have gotten.
Eddie Rabbit.
I know, right? Like, who would have ever thought that he toured and somebody went and bought it and then somebody bought it to resell it? Like, I don't know. Raindrops, you know. But you see stuff like that and you're going, $75, huh? And then you also figure out why now you see Kim Kardashian and these folks wearing Rat T-shirts or Metallica or Megadeth T-shirts, and they look worn. They're buying them in these shops, and they're paying way too much money. Yeah. I mean, shit, concert shirts are $50 now at shows. I mean, you think that's expensive. How about a used one in 10 years for $300?
Right.
Honestly, I don't mind the $50 t-shirts anymore at shows because, you know, we've all seen firsthand that, you know, that's the only way a musician's going to make money. You know, mm-hmm. Right now, I mean, original music is not a very profitable business.
Yeah. I also think it depends on the band, too.
Well, it does. I mean, there's definitely bands that have that thing about it where you have to own their merch and you want to buy all their stuff. But, you know, like me, like every shirt Clutch puts out, I'll get because I think I like the band.
Right, but Clutch isn't charging $50.
At their shows, I'm sure they are.
You think so?
Dude, it is $50 is the new standard.
I was just at the Idol show and it was like $25.
Well, that's definitely a new thing. And not only that, the venues take like 20% of your sales.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Oh, yeah. Especially like the 930s, like the bigger venues. Yeah. Like I don't think the Auto Bar takes a cut of merch, but the bigger venues, yeah, you got to pay. I think we played a venue and I think it was 20%.
Huh.
Yeah. And then in Los Angeles, you have to pay 20%, but only on... It's like it's either only on clothes or only on recorded music. Like it's one or the other. You have to like split your. I don't know. It's a crazy world. Anyways, let's get and talk about the subject which I talked to you both about before, which is stuff that could not come out today. We're talking music, TV, movies. I'm going to go over the music stuff first, and then we'll get into the TV and movies. And that is because I found a list that I think has mostly songs that all of us would know. Of songs that could not be released today. And let's get you guys' take on this. Let's see. Kiss, Going Blind. That's the first one on here.
What's in it? What's in it? What's what's the line that messes you up today?
You know what? Holy crap. Oh, here's the line. Little lady, can't you see? You're so young and so much different than I. I'm 93. I'm 93 and you're 16. Can't you see I'm going blind?
Oh my God. There's so many songs like that.
That's
too.
What most
16. So beautiful. There's one that talks about a girl that's like 13,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah, I think that's on this list too.
Yeah. And plus the Melvins covered that song. Like
Yeah, oh yeah.
I guess that was 20 years ago
I think it was taken off the album, wasn't it? Or
was
something?
It really?
I think so. But
not
yeah,
because
of
the lyrics, probably.
No, they just probably from a...
How about in My Sharona where the line goes, I like the touch of the younger kind.
Yes, I remember that line, yeah. That was on one list that I saw. I like the touch of the younger kind. Well, you know, the thing about it is when you're looking at this, you're looking at it from the perspective of that musician today. Meaning, like, when I hear 17 by Winger, I'm going, creepy 60-year-old Winger talking about a 17-year-old girl.
Right.
But I think that these songs were written for kids, meaning for younger... Like, the songs are written for young people. So it wasn't like Kip Winger wanted a 17-year-old girl. I think he was doing it so...
Yeah.
So a 16 or a 17 or 18-year-old boy or girl could sing that song.
Right.
It's not as inappropriate.
Well, it's written for a young kid as if the writer was a young kid. But we all know they didn't start when they were 16.
I know.
So
well, just,
that's
it's
the
just
weird.
Like, is it the songwriter or is it a narrator? That's also a narrator.
I think with the Kiss song, this lyric is, I'm 93, you're 16. I think that's supposed to be funny. You know what I mean? I don't think that's...
Okay, I got one. I got one that people don't know about. Have you ever looked at the lyrics to Rolling Stones?
Yes, that is on this list, and I actually have the line. Where is it? Dude, the Rolling Stones are on this list so many times.
Yes,
there's some on here that I agree with.
They've got many
that, but for sure, the Rolling Stones one is one of the most cringe out of all of them, I believe. You know what? It's not on this one list, so I can't find... But, I mean, it's like Whipping Slaves.
Yeah.
Do you have the line? I can't believe it's not...
I don't have it looked up, but I think it's not... I don't think it's
one
line. No,
it's a whole
line.
It's a whole verse.
The entire thing is about slave masters going and having sex with the young slaves and whipping them into submission.
And this
submission.
Song is played at weddings.
And then the saxophone goes.
So
That's the most defensive card is the saxophone.
So I got. So here's the line. It's Gold Coast slave ship bound for the cotton fields. I mean, dude, you know, how many things does he have to say for us to know what he's talking about there? Jesus. Sold in the market down in New Orleans. Scared old slaver knows he's doing all right. Hear him whip the women just around midnight.
Women just around midnight. Yeah.
But my thing is, how can you say that song wouldn't be made today when it's played all over the place today?
Right. That's the thing.
Because people don't know the words. They just know the
brand. Right. Right. And they don't listen. The one that I hear constantly on the radio, on the 80s stations and the classic rock stations, is that Dire Straits, Money for Nothing.
Oh, right. Yeah.
Yeah. They drop a hard
like
F.
Like several times.
Many
it's,
hard
It's
F.
in the pre-chorus.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
I think, right?
Yeah.
Oh, no. It's the second verse or something.
Yeah. Yeah.
Dude, that one is...
They could that never one, play if, that.
They play it on the radio now, but like if Justin Bieber had that song and it came out, it wouldn't be out.
Right. Yeah. That's the thing, like ironic homophobia, ironic racism just doesn't really do it anymore. You know what I mean?
No, right.
Yeah.
Yeah, the irony. It's there's no more irony thanks to our former president.
Everything has to be
I think a lot of the things that used to be kind of trolling got outdone by the master of all trolls.
Yeah.
That's kind of, it messed up a lot of comedians too. You know, they were like, oh, maybe we need to back off a little bit because it looks like we're supporting 45. But,
we actually talked about that was that the intro of the show? Or is that just us talking earlier?
Yeah, I think it was just us talking earlier. Yeah.
We were talking about how it's really hurt.
The best material we leave off the show.
But we were talking mostly about Dave Chappelle, and maybe it was all because his perspective is his actual life. Like when he talks about it, he talks about I was in this bar with this tranny, or what, like he says those things, and a lot of other comedians, it's not that they do it in character, but they're making it more of like a you're with me, right? You know what I'm talking about. And Dave's like, you know,
right. Dave used to have a character, and he used to say all sorts of like weird stuff, and you'd go, ha ha ha, that's ridiculous, that's over the top. When he came back from his little vacation after his out and out with Comedy Central, he came back as a different person, and he didn't go into character anymore. He was I'm Dave, and he'd have a C on
like
the side of his arm, so you knew who was talking. It's me.
Yeah.
This is what I think.
Think about that.
And that, I think that was his mistake too. There's no character. Yeah. And Always Sunny with Philadelphia, they're playing Archie Bunker characters. Yeah,
right.
And they want you to know we're playing the most despicable character on earth. Don't follow us unless you're following us late. You're watching Goodfellas.
It's
Larry
not
David
a,
too. Like
Curb. Oh, Larry, Curb. Larry David does that too. Yeah. But he does it an interesting way because it is him.
Right, yeah.
It's an exaggerated character version of him.
Right.
Because if Danny DeVito said the things that he says on that show as Danny DeVito, like, forget about it. Yeah. he'd have been canceled long ago.
He actually believes the opposite of a lot of the stuff in the lines there, which is kind of cool.
I think that, I mean... Look at who is that guy? Right,
that was Carol O'Connor and Archie Bunker, like the actor. He was like a big time role.
Yeah. I mean, you never know. I mean, it's like who's the guy? One of the best TV characters ever. On Ray Donovan. It's what's his name? Midnight Cowboy. John Voight.
Oh right. Okay.
His character is he's I would say liberal, but like he's mixed race. Like he's whatever And in real life, he's like the biggest Trump supporter there ever was.
Right,
he's
like
super, super this and that. Yeah. It's like, it's the opposite where like I think his real life is despicable, but I like his character. So you can get a lot of that back and forth there. But yeah, you're right. I mean, Always Sunny, like it takes things definitely to the farthest extent of like I'm still like, ooh, man, they really did that, didn't they? Letterkenny does that as well. Because the way that they deal with homophobics and all these people, like they have them portrayed, I think, in a ridiculous light. But it's funny because that shit really could happen.
Right. Yeah, it's all caricatures and stereotypes.
Right. And also, with Dave Chappelle on his show, he could play anybody. You know, he was the blind racist. You know, like, he could play all those characters, and we would laugh along. But if he was on stage with the C, and he starts talking about racism, like, it's like, oh, well, okay, now we're hearing that.
Right. He came back a different person.
Totally. That's right. So,
hey, back to the music. I got one that I actually took notes for, because I remember people used to sing this for karaoke when I was a karaoke host.
Used to bother the shit out of you.
Gary Puckett, Young Girl. It's Young Girl, Get Out of My Mind. My Love for You is Way Out of Time. No, Way Out of Line. You'd Better Run, Girl. You're Much Too Young, Girl. So he's telling the woman, run from me. I'm
a pedophile, so get the hell out of here.
Yeah, yeah. But it's all on you. Oh, it's all on you to get away.
Young girl, get out of my... Oh, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Oh,
God.
Young girl, get out of my mind. My love for you was way out of line. It's like he knows he's out of line, but he's putting it on you.
To get out. Because I can't help myself. So, now...
A couple of these
aren't too crazy, but, you know, Rape Me by Nirvana. People say it couldn't come out today. I think that's bullshit. I think it could totally come out today.
The way he's singing it.
I think on this list I'm reading, it's just because...
I mean, you have to completely miss the point.
Yeah, to think that is out of line. Yeah. Kissing Cousins by Elvis. I mean, that's not that inappropriate, I guess. It's just about...
How about Under My Thumb?
That is on my list, too. That was...
Under My... When she's spoken to, Squirm Dog has just had her day.
Yeah, so it's totally a
that's extremely
That's what it is. Under My Thumb, Squirming Dog Who's Just Had Her Day. Under My Thumb, A Girl Who Just Changed Her Ways. Oof. Yeah, that is
yikes. I mean, that was yikes for when it came out. Yeah. Really. People just didn't really, they were like, yeah.
Used to love her, but I had to kill her. Guns N' Roses. I think that could totally come out today. I mean, it's...
And a lot of these writers, like the Beatles, when they're like, write these songs, they're saying that they're writing as a spoof for the guys that used to write these songs.
Yeah, like they're all Steel Panther like, now.
Well,
with the Guns N' Roses, I'm 99% sure it was about his dog. I used to love her, but I had to kill her because he had to put down his dog.
I think that's something
Slash said to defend Axl. Run for Your Life, the Beatles.
Run for Your Life. Yeah, that's what the one I was thinking about.
You better run for your life if you can, little girl. Hide your head in the sand, little girl. Catch you with another man, that's the end, little girl.
Yeah, I mean, there's songs that have like... It's like conceptual art. You go to an art studio and you look at all this conceptual art that means nothing to you unless the person who made it comes up and goes, yeah, well, the meaning behind that is. So the Beatles have this song and it's out in the ether, but Lennon says, hey, I was just writing it in the term to spoof the old blues writers that used to write songs like that. It's like, without him saying that, it's just out there as an offensive, weird song.
There's a whole genre of like country called murder ballads.
Yeah.
You know, that's basically the same thing as that.
Kind of like Hey Joe or something.
Right,
like,
yeah, exactly.
That's not country, but that kind of theme.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I'm trying to think of a song. It's definitely not on any list, but I know it for myself because it would make me cringe in the 80s, was the Dead Milkmen, Tiny Town. In that song, the singer is playing somebody from a tiny town. Like, he's playing a racist, bigot, jerk. Like, right. That. The whole song is him playing that character. You know, he's like, we hate blacks and we hate Jews and all this kind of stuff, but he's talking as... his perspective from being in a band going into a tiny town and the experience he had. But hearing those words still bugged the shit out of me, even though I knew it was coming from a character. It made it hard to like that song. It's the same thing.
I think here with a sitcom and a movie to do that first person character thing in comedians. In songs, it's just lyrics and music and there's no explanation.
Exactly.
You know?
I mean, and that goes right into that Guns N' Roses song that I know Slash can't defend, which is One in a Million, which they've now actually removed it from their box sets, and they're starting to take it out of things.
Oh, really?
Do you know those words there, Landis? It's bad.
Yeah, it's another F-bomb.
Yeah, lots of N's and F's in this one. It's police and N's. That's right. Get out of my way. Don't need to buy none of your gold chains today. As well as immigrants and F's. They make no sense to me. They come to our country and think they do as they please. Oof.
Yeah.
Ouch. That should have just been stricken.
Right.
You know what? There's another Guns N' Roses song that I've never seen on any of these lists, but it bugged the shit out of me when my kid would listen to it and I like paid attention to the lyrics because there's no cursing. I think it's just like, back up, bitch, I got news for you. You know, bend over. You know, I got nothing better to do and I'm bored. Like, talking about just bending over some girl,
right,
like, banging her. Like, oh shit. Like, I was like, I can't do, I can't let him listen to this. Right. Like, that's not how, that's not, you know, that was without the naughty words. That one was like, dude. Elton John's Island Girl. I don't think it's really racist.
Island Girl.
I don't know if
it's
racist. I think it's, you know, he got a crush. I don't know. How bad are the words?
Yeah. The way he speaks in the lyrics, it's kind of 70s. It was a different time.
Yeah. Baby,
yeah, there's like a lot of Zappa stuff like that where it's like,
oh,
rock the cradle of love.
Yeah. Billy Idol. Yeah, that one is. Yeah. I mean, he literally went to cradle. He wasn't even talking about a 17-year-old girl. Let's take it all the way back to the babies. Jesus. I mean, I know that it's a, you know, it's just a term of rocking the cradle or robbing the cradle or something like that. Right. And maybe he shouldn't have made a song about it. Maybe. Baby, It's Cold Outside. Everybody's talked about that one. Yeah, it's rapey.
Yeah.
Like, you know, that maybe that one should just, you know, I'm not saying to completely cancel it, but maybe it shouldn't be in the top 10 of every Christmas station. You know, like
another song kind of like that is the Pointer Sisters. What is it?
Interesting ones, dude.
Fire.
Oh, I don't know that one.
Because one of the lines is, I'm saying no, but you know, let me look up the lyrics.
Springsteen song?
No, Pointer Sisters.
Yeah, but I think that was a cover
of a Springsteen song.
Yeah. Huh.
Was it? Yeah, that's right. Yes, it was Springsteen.
Wow. While you're looking that up, I'll scroll through a couple. I mean, Blurred Lines, that's fine. It's most offensive that he stole the music from Marvin Gaye, but that's more offensive than the lines in the song. You want to hug me? What rhymes with hug me? What, bug me? Like, come on, dude. Just get a word that rhymes with fuck. Like, come on. Hug, bug. There's a bunch of country ones on here that I can skip because, yeah, they're probably racist. Short People by Randy Newman. I always kind of thought of that as like a parody song anyway.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
I didn't think that
was. Although it used to bug me when I listened to it, because he doesn't say it's a parody. Yeah. He just says it. And in the 70s, it's kind of hard to tell. They had a lot of songs in the 70s about people hanging themselves and towns catching on fire. And, you know, it's kind of hard to tell. Here's the lyrics. Sisters. I'm driving in my car. I turn on the radio. I'm pulling you close. You just say no. You say you don't like it. But girl, I know you're a liar. Because, ooh, when we kiss, it's fire.
Oof.
Yeah.
Lots of racist stuff in here, man. It's like we're reliving that scene in Back to the Future over and over again.
But the Pointer Sisters sing it, and they don't change the lyrics. They're saying, I'm telling you no, but you know I'm a liar. It's like, wow.
So they're changing the first person.
Yeah, because Springsteen's going,
I'm a liar. Oof.
No.
Yeah.
And you know I'm a liar. It's like, how do I know that?
There's Sammy Hagar, Cruising and Boozing. I don't know. It's about drinking and driving. Okay, whatever. That's not that offensive to me. And just don't do it, you know. Isn't there like a ska song? Like the Specials had a song called Drinking and Driving is So Much Fun. I don't know.
Oh, did they?
Yeah. Well, I will tell you what. Here's a drunk driving something that is a... Motley Crue put out a box set a few years ago called songs to crash your car to.
No way. No, they didn't.
Guaranteed. I'll show you it. It really happened.
Wow.
Yeah. They say that the record label did it without them knowing, but coming from a band who, you know, killed somebody in a drunk driving accident.
Right.
Yeah. I'll see if I can. I'll see if I can find that. I saw that recently. Kung Fu Fighting. Is it a fun song or is it racist?
I don't know.
I mean, I'm not Japanese, or, you know, I'm not Asian, so I can't say that he's being racist against me. I don't know. I kind of always thought it was.
What's the line that's the danger line?
Is it just like an appropriation thing? Or?
They were funky Chinamen from funky Chinatown, and then were funky Billy Chin and little Sammy Chung. Oof. All right, man. Maybe that one should move to the back of the playlist.
Comes off as a little ignorant.
This is a song I don't know. I'd probably need to hear it to know if I know it. Every Picture Tells a Story by Rod Stewart. Like, I don't know. It's not one of his giant hits.
Every picture tells a story, it?
Okay, yeah. And this wonderful line, I fell in love with a slit-eyed lady. Oof. Yeah. Yeah.
Yikes!
By the light of the eastern moon, Shanghai little never used the pill. She claimed that it ain't natural. Okay.
I used to think My Little China Girl by Bowie.
That's on here.
That's actually an Iggy Pop song.
Oh, I didn't know that.
But yeah.
And it makes me sense when Iggy sings it for some reason, because he's like, the way I am will mess up your world. Yeah. And you understand. And he's like, China, like she's made out of China, and I'm like a bull in a China shop. And when Bowie sings it, he's like, little, you just hush your mouth. Right. Oh, she
and
says,
it's,
and it's like,
right,
whoa!
It's using like the kind of stereotypical, and the video, and it's like David Bowie's actually doing like the slant eyes thing.
Also referring to a grown woman as a little girl is also
that
disrespect.
The slit eye thing is really weird, and it reminds me of, it's not on most lists, but do you remember Genesis had a song called Illegal Alien?
Oh, right, yeah. and he would put on that kind of accent.
Yeah, he puts on the accent and wears sombreros in the video. Like, the subject of the song isn't... It's actually in defense of immigrants.
Right.
But you wouldn't know it if you didn't research it. And it's such a horrible song. I'm an illegal alien. Like, oof.
Yeah.
God. You know, the police don't stand so close to me. I don't see that as being... like a pedophile kind of thing.
It's that one's actually, you kind of get that.
That one, I get that.
Because I don't think that's first. It doesn't strike you that he's singing it in first person.
Oh boy, and Rod Stewart back on the petty list. Oof, this one's rough. This is for Tonight's Gonna Be All Right, which is a very popular song. I'd never heard this lyric. Loosen off that pretty French gown. Let me pour you a good long drink. Oh, baby, don't you hesitate, because tonight's the night. Don't deny your man's desires. You'd be a fool to stop this tide. Spread your wings and let me come inside. Tonight, tonight. I mean, the song has been played a billion times. Whoa, that one was hidden. I Love the Dead by Alice Cooper. It's a necrophilia song. It doesn't bother me. Just because it's horror shock rock, so... that's pretty much it for the list. There's a couple other Christine 16 by Kiss. You know, the part where he sees her coming out of school. Like, that's the creepy part, mostly to me. It's not like he's talking about a young girl. He's like watching her get off the school bus
Which means he's too old for school.
Because he's skipping class. but there's a bunch on this list that are just silly, like
Cocaine by Eric Clapton.
I think
that's not him either. That's
Heroin, Velvet Underground.
Heroin? Yeah, Heroin. Yeah. I mean, you know, it's no wet ass pussy. I mean, that's coming out today. I mean, how ridiculous and offensive is that?
Anything, X for some reason is fine, and that's like the only avenue people can go all the way in with lyrics is straight sex.
It's like Sugar Walls by Vanity.
Straight consensual sex.
God, I forgot. Landis and I used to play that when we would DJ together. Yeah, remember Sugar Walls?
Yeah.
That was the wet ass pussy of its day.
Yes, it was.
Yeah. It was.
Hey Joe by Jimi Hendrix. I mean, first off, that's a cover, and second off, like, it's just about a murder. Like, it's not. Yeah, it's
right.
Yeah, lists are lists, but I do want to talk briefly because there was a lot of this little weird rapey stuff. Since my kids are 12 and 10, they're getting a little older. I'm letting them watch certain movies that I wouldn't when they were younger. You know, a lot of the 80s movies that I love, I've let them watch some of those, but I've gone back and watched or looked up some of these movies, and I definitely think they wouldn't be able to come out today. 16 Candles is one of the rapiest movies ever. There's like four different things in that movie that's like really cringe. There's so much stuff in that one.
I have not seen that movie. God.
I mean, there's a
whole... Hey, you know what movie's rapey, but no one's talked about it yet? Rocky Horror Picture Show. Is that not a straight-up rapey movie?
Huh. Do you think they got away with it because of the transsexual...
Because of the time. Right. It's the 70s.
It's like the Pepe Le Pew type thing.
Oh, yeah. We don't got Pepe Le Pew. Yeah, that's... Woo!
Yeah.
What was the other one?
That time, like, over the top, like, you know, it was like, people thought that it was funny back then, I guess.
Well, because they turn it, it's a character doing
it.
It's not me.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. Pepe Le Pew was rough, and Speedy Gonzalez, too. I mean, we don't even need.
Well, they hadn't opened these conversations yet back then either. You know, things were the way they were, and people were like,
I guess it started with the cartoons during World War II. Where it was more like the anti-Nazi and anti-Japanese and, you know, those things where they did some of the kind of slant eyes and, you know, bombings and stuff. But it's when it got past that and got into, like, the 70s and stuff with the Pepe Le Pew and a lot of those. I guess it's more stereotypical stuff than blatant racism. But, it's more like, okay, he's the Mexican mouse and... He's fast, and he talks fast, and he wears a sombrero, and he's got this accent, you know? Right. I don't think that there was... I guess you have to figure out if that in itself is derogatory, or it's just stereotypical.
Well, look, if it came out during World War II, there were a lot of things happening in World War II in our country that allowed that war to happen and to go on. Oh. You know, there was a lot of racism that was... okay for, you know, okay for Congress people to be straight up like have like Nazi cards in their wallet. That was just
what we think,
Nazis weren't American, but there were American Nazis during that time, and that's why that war went on so long.
I mean, what, the Japanese camps that they put the American Japanese in camps? Yeah.
Right.
Like, Jesus.
That all led to it. That all culminated into a thing. Now, you know, we're having these conversations. Slowly, we're taking everything apart and going, what's the matter with us that we allowed this to happen? Like, I spoke to you the other day. We talk about we villainized Bill Cosby. Yeah. What he did was bad. But we don't open up the conversation and go, how is he able to get Spanish fly? Right. Was it being sold openly on the market? Hell yes, it was. It was being sold everywhere. It was being sold here in Baltimore and Howard Street in the 80s. It was being sold in New York. It was just a thing you could just, it was in videos. It was videos.
So that was also it was? Brass Monkey and what was the Funky Cold Medina. Very rapey songs.
One of the ones they changed the lyrics
to? It was part of our
cult. The Beasties?
Yeah. And we
I just don't
about
think
it.
They'd play it.
Oh.
I think it's one of the, like, they say they wish they never did that, and they never did the song Girls, and they just don't. I mean, they're still getting royalties. They're not blacking that out because,
Jammy
Good Jams. Point. We did a instrumental cover of Girls, and they took the money. I mean, whatever. Mm-hmm. I mean, for them, it's like that's how we were, and that was ridiculous. It was supposed to be a parody of, you know, crazy frat guys, and they became our fans. I don't know. Mm-hmm. So yeah, but you know, opening the conversation, it takes a lot. So when you, I mean, you write so many songs. So Landis with his Landis Harry Larry act just put out 39 songs. No, sorry. Yeah, 39 songs on three albums on the same day. So you're talking 39 songs, and you know, some of your lyrical content goes in so many different directions. A lot of it's corny and funny, hilarious. Some of it gets a little deep. It gets a little political here and there, but not too much. Like, where do you draw the line on how far you want to go writing lyrics?
Well, I try not to write about what you hear a lot about in songs. So relationships, love, and sex are totally off limits for LHL off the bat. I actually tried to find a 90s song that we could cover that was cool. That, yeah. And all the good ones were about relationships. I couldn't find one.
All the songs out there, you can't find one. Yeah, that's crazy.
I figure love is a thing that like everyone's going to experience in their own kind of way. And there isn't a normal way to experience it. It's very personal. So I don't want to bore people with my version of like what I, you know, it's like putting religion in your song. It's like, well, I believe, you know, just write a song, you know, about something that I do. Like I have a song called Spam Risk. I figure everybody gets a phone call where it says Spam Risk on it. That's something we unites the entire country.
Absolutely.
You know, I got a spam.
And even trolling, almost the same thing. Like everybody's been trolled on hard, you know, and it's just great because it seems, I mean, the content, the amount of content that you're able to put out and these songs that you're able to write, and they're all on completely different. I mean, one song's about, you know, hey, I've been in lockdown for 2 years. What am I going to wear when I go outside? Like, what am I going to wear now? Mm-hmm. You know, to me, that's like everybody would go through that, you know? So all of those things, I think that's why you connect so well with people and they fall in love. And of course, the videos are so, I mean, they're just incredible. They're so unique to you and what you do. I mean, there's plenty of people out there that have done stuff with green screens or done stuff with crazy costumes, but when you see an LHL video, you immediately know it's an LHL video. Before you see the little identifier in the bottom corner, you know what it is. I mean, maybe with the exception of Flesh Bags, but you know, that was kind of in the same vein as Adapt and Playthings Are Us. It was just that darker black and white kind of thing. So even though it was a different kind of animation and different themes, it still fit in there. It was still unique to LHL, which is awesome. So 39 new songs, 3 albums. So here's the deal. We've talked about Landis Harry Larry on this show before a couple times. Landis, we're looking at him right now. He's real. Harry and Larry, they're clones, right? So they can't always go out to the performances and play with Landis, but they all did their own solo albums. Each of these albums, Landis, Harry, and Larry, they have a distinct feel. I think that each album has, you know, similar beats and similar sounds and different themes there. And that's what I really love, because when Landis first came up with the concept and was talking to me about doing these solo albums, it was kind of like, all right, well, there's already this stack of songs that he's already written, and they weren't assigned to certain members of the band. So I'd have to say, like, okay, who would this be? And he said, oh, that's a Harry song, for sure. And that's how we started to kind of, like, organize them out, and the finished product I just love. It's available for streaming on Spotify and Apple Music and everything, Landis Harry Larry. We have even... For his first album, The Story of Bunch, and the 3 new albums are all available on CD, and all of them are available on cassette. And the 3 new albums, you can pre-order on vinyl, which hopefully we'll see before 2023. Vinyl back in May.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Wow.
I mean, it can take up to 12 weeks or 12 to 24 weeks. Yeah. So vinyl is
it could be any day now.
Any day now. That's right. If you order now, any day now. We will have them soon. I keep checking. Like, hey, remember me? Remember us? Remember me and Landis? Remember we paid to get these things made? Yeah. So they are out there, though. But you can hear all of Landis's beautiful music with Landis Harry Larry. Also, I wanted to talk right before we end today's show about this really interesting thing that Landis just did. So you can't really go out and live perform Landis Hairy Larry, right? He makes all these songs in his studio. So last year when he made his live debut, he called it the LHL Band. And you had what? Guitar, bass, synth, backup singers, and Landis played the drums and sang. And it was awesome. And then they did that again two more times this year. But I was talking to him, and I'm like, I love the songs. Everybody played wonderful. They're all great musicians. Everything's perfect. It just didn't give me the feeling that I get when I'm watching the videos. Right? You know, like these sounds and stuff. So, yeah, all electric. So Landis went out and performed an outdoor show as Landis Hairy Larry, but it was just him. So he's got some tracks going on. He's playing the keyboards live. He's got a microphone, like, headset that he's singing all the live parts, and it was fantastic.
Yeah.
I mean, so good. It's up on, I think you put that on your YouTube page, right? Yeah.
It's on the YouTube page.
Landis Expandis on YouTube. It's really cool. Watching him do all that stuff live is fantastic. And, dude, I mean, I like both of them, but I love that he's able to do that, where he can go out and play a big live band show, but he can also go into a club where normally it's just a DJ, and he could DJ and then do live LHL stuff. I think it's really, really awesome. So if you can catch any of his shows, boy, oh boy, we're doing all outdoor shows right now until all this stuff, you know. I mean, since the last time we all talked, you know, Trav and I have both had went through COVID.
Yeah.
So it's still out there, man, and we need to keep it away from Landis.
Yeah, I'm thinking next year possibly doing a busking tour where I just take the solo act and I just, you know, play Frederick, go up to New York, Chicago, whatever. All the outside joints or street corners with
where
awesome.
They
let
me play.
I mean,
that would be so freaking cool, man. I think that's the way to do it. I mean, places like Frederick, Maryland, small town, but still a lot of people. I mean, you go outside of the comic book shop and set up for 2 hours on a Saturday morning or afternoon. I think that would go really well. I mean, dude, it would go well even down here in Bethesda. Like the downtown here, everybody's on foot. You know, there's a really cool skate shop down there. Like you could probably set up right in front of the skate shop and do it. I think you just have to worry about making sure that licenses and stuff so you don't get in trouble for that kind of stuff. But anyways, that's going to wrap up today's episode. Big Curve Podcast. Oh, and Landis also did our theme song that you heard at the top of the show.
Big Curve,
you know what I didn't ask you?
Podcast.
Is that a production of Landis Expandis or Landis Hairy Larry?
That's definitely Landis, Harry, and Larry.
I want to be able to identify it specifically so, you know, people know what to look up.
And you hear the keyboards, and then, like, Harry will come in with some goofy backing track, you know, falsetto. That's the LHL
awesome.
Sound.
All right, cool, man. Well, this is going to wrap up Big Curve Podcast episode number 4. If you enjoy the show and you want to hear some of the music that we were talking about on the show, go over to Mixcloud, look up Big Curve Podcast, and go to episode 4.5. All the episodes on Mixcloud that have a 0.5 are all music shows, because we can't play music on this show because we want it to be on Spotify and Apple Podcasts and all that kind of stuff. So that's where you're going to find it. You can go to LandisExpandis.com, BigCurveMusic.net. And got any parting words here, Trampas?
See you later.
Hey, remember that band we were in?
Absolutely, yeah.
Dugan.
Yeah.
I wish there was a recording somewhere of Dugan.
I was talking to Mark the other day. He might have something. Yeah? I might have. We're digging around for it
now. Both of you have individually told me that it was like Mark wrote some of the heaviest shit ever.
Oh, yeah.
And I've never heard any of it, and I'm dying to hear. I love Mark's playing, and to hear him like knock out some super heavy shit would be awesome. Yeah. Speaking of which, new Nova Colosso album coming out a little later this year. We got the Shit re-release of their album coming out in 2 weeks. We got a new Dingleberry Dynasty Dingle single. The very first ever Dingle single is coming out next Tuesday. It's called Totally Effed. And we got new stuff from Megazillion, new stuff from 51 Peg. Early next year, there'll be new stuff from American Jet Set. We got new stuff from Hand Apple. We got new stuff from DeToro. God, I hope I didn't forget. Oh, the Neurofarm. Maybe next year with some new stuff. They got a bunch of stuff. So go to BigCurveMusic.com. No, don't go there. Go to bigcurvemusic.net. We will see you guys later. Thank you, Landis, for joining us on the show.
All right, thank you.
Take it easy, dude.
Good seeing you again.
Yeah.
Right.
All right. And from myself and Trampas, we'll see you guys on the next Big Curve Podcast.